أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ثم أما بعد فقد قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد نعلم إنه ليحزنك الذي يقولون فإنهم لا يكذبونك ولكن الظالمين بآيات الله يجحدون صدق الله العلي العظيم عطروا أفواهكم وزينوا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الحمد لله it's a pleasure and it's a privilege to spend this night in the month of Ramadan with you as we ponder and reflect over the verses of Surah An'aam. We reached ayah number 33, so inshallah, I'll read the translation for you and inshallah we'll begin with our discussion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 33, he addresses the Holy Prophet. And he says, قَدْ نَعْلَمُ إِنَّهُ لَيَحْزُنُكَ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ We know that you, O Muhammad, are saddened by what they say. فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ And indeed, they do not call you untruthful. But it is the signs of Allah that the wrongdoers reject. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is essentially consoling the Holy Prophet. Now, interestingly, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet, we know that you, O Muhammad, are saddened by what they say. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention what was being said to the Holy Prophet, at least in this verse. But we know that when we read other verses of the Holy Quran, when you examine the seerah of the Holy Prophet, you find that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was met with hostile opposition. That the mushrikeen of Mecca, they rarely attack what is being said, but rather they engage in character assassination. They try to belittle the Prophet. They call him a madman. They call him a magician. So they start to make personal attacks against the Holy Prophet. Now, it's interesting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, we know that you, O Muhammad, are saddened by what they say, Allah uses the majestic we here. He doesn't say, I know that you, O Muhammad, are saddened by what they say. Allah uses the plural form. نَعْلَمُ He doesn't say, قَدْ أَعْلَمُ Now this could be because the majestic we, it's possible that it's being used here because only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about this sadness that is in the heart of the Holy Prophet. Meaning no one else would have known that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is in grief and he's saddened by this. Because when you look at, when you study the biography of the Prophet and you read the ahadith that describe his behavior and his mannerism, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi was always very cheerful. Even when he was experiencing tribulation, it would be very difficult to notice that the Holy Prophet is saddened or he's experiencing grief or distress. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he was known as someone who was always very cheerful. He was always smiling. In fact, one of the wives of the Holy Prophet, when she was asked to describe Rasulullah, because again, you know, the wives of the Prophet, they see him when he's in private. You know, there are some individuals, they have a dual personality. They behave a certain way in public, but behind closed doors, they have an entirely different personality. So this individual is asking one of the wives of the Prophet, describe Rasulullah to us. You know, you see him when none of us see him. She says, كَانَ أَلْيَنَ النَّاسِ وَأَكْرَمَ النَّاسِ, that the Holy Prophet was the most lenient of people. You know, when you think of a religious person, you know, Rasulullah is the most religious person. Unfortunately, today, religiosity has negative connotations. You know, if you try to picture a religious person in your mind, you probably have the image of someone who's very strict, inflexible, you know, maybe judgmental, very uptight. Whereas the Holy Prophet is described as alyan an-nas, that he was so lenient. He was strict with himself, but he was very lenient with other people. And he was the most generous, wa akram an-nas. Wa kana rajulan min rijalikum. He was as normal as one of your men. He was very humble. And then she says, and this is what I want to highlight, إِلَّا أَنَّهُ كَانَ ضَحَاكًا بَسَّامًا. What made the Holy Prophet distinctly different from others was that he was always smiling. He was always very pleasant. He was always cheerful. So sadness, brothers and sisters, sometimes it's not always visible. You know, sometimes someone may be grieving or they may have a deep sadness within them, and you would never know it. Here, it's possible that many of the companions thought that Rasulullah is not experiencing any psychological pain. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet that we know that you, O Muhammad, are saddened by what they say. Now, what is making the Prophet sad? Is it because the Prophet is sad because people are making fun of him? No, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, you know, he's not brought down by personal attacks. What makes him sad is that he's sincerely trying to guide these people. He's inviting them to a way of life that will enrich their lives, a way of life that will offer them true prosperity, but they refuse. It's similar to a parent who wants the best for their child. And when their child misbehaves or they don't do good in school, the parent is affected by it. Why? Because the parent wishes the best for the child. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he is in the position of a spiritual parent. He is the spiritual parent of humanity. And all human beings are like his children. So when he sees his spiritual children deviate and display stubbornness and rebelliousness, it bothers the Prophet. It saddens him. And this is the case not only with Rasulullah. This is the quality of a mu'min, that sadness is not visible on the face of a believer. No matter what they go through in life, they're always very pleasant, they're always smiling. There's a hadith from Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi alayhi, where the Imam alayhi salam, he describes the mu'min, he describes the believer. He says, "Inna bishra al-mu'min fi wajhi." The cheerfulness, the happiness of a believer is evident in his face. وَقُوَّتُهُ فِي دِينِهِ, and the strength of a believer comes from his faith. And then the hadith says, وَحُزْنَهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ, and the grief and the sadness of a believer is in his heart. Meaning, a believer, you know, there are some people when they're sad, when they're upset, they have to let everybody know, and they have to make everybody depressed. Whereas the mu'min is cheerful, they're very pleasant. You could never notice sadness in them. They keep it to themselves, because they recognize the only one who can alleviate their sadness is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, these are individuals, this is the level of their tawheed, where they don't only recognize Allah as the only creator, as the only provider, as the only Lord of the heavens and the earth, but they also see Him as the only source of joy, the only one who is able to alleviate sadness from the heart. So again, you find that the Quran frequently consoles the Prophet, telling him that don't grieve too much for those who reject the message. Allah is reminding the Prophet that the problem is not with you, that you're not, people are not flocking to you now. It's not because you're failing. It's not because you're making mistakes. It's not because you're falling short. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the Prophet that their rejection of the truth is not because you're not a good messenger. You only have control over your effort. You don't have control of the results. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, if you look at Surah Al-Kahf, ayah number 6, Surah 18, ayah number 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, He consoles the Prophet. It seems that the Prophet had a habit that when he would see the Meccans, when he would see the disbelievers turn away and deny Allah's signs, it would bother him, brothers and sisters. It would really affect him. To the extent that Allah in Surah Al-Kahf, ayah number 6, what does He say? To Rasulullah, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِن لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Ya Rasulullah, it's almost as though you're gonna die because of grief, because of the fact that they are turning away from the truth, that they are rejecting the truth. I'll give you a couple more examples. I'll just give you the surah and the ayah number. These are also other verses where Allah consoles the Holy Prophet. If in Surah Ali Imran, Surah number 3, verse 176, another verse where Allah consoles the Prophet. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah 5, verse 41, again, another instance where we see divine consolation to the Prophet. In Surah Yasin, Surah number 36, ayah number 76, again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoles the Prophet. Now, the lesson for us, my dear brothers and sisters, is, you know, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, someone who is as spiritually refined as him, needs consolation when he's experiencing sadness, why is it that when people are depressed in our communities, you know, we act as though, oh, that's something that you have to kind of fix on your own? That in the same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to console the Prophet, when we see individuals who are down or depressed in our communities, we should also console them. We should reach out to them. Now, it's interesting that when you look at this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet that, and indeed they do not call you untruthful. Allah is telling the Prophet that they're not rejecting Islam because they think that you're a liar. In fact, on the contrary, these kuffar, these mushrikeen, they are the same ones who gave you the title As-Sadiq al-Amin. In fact, even now, we said Surah Al-An'am was a late Meccan surah. Do you know, brothers and sisters, even up until now, the Meccans still have their valuables with Rasulullah. You know, during the time of Jahiliyyah, and even up until now, there were no banks in Mecca. People couldn't take, there were no safety deposit box for people to deposit their gold or their silver or their money. So the people of Mecca, many of them, they would leave their valuables with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And even when he began his prophetic mission and he was inviting them and they rejected him and they were slandering him and mocking him and harassing him, they didn't say, give us our valuables back. They still knew that the safest place for their valuables is with Muhammad. So much so that even when they plotted to assassinate him, Rasulullah leaves Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam behind in Mecca. One of the reasons why Rasulullah migrates to Medina and leaves Amir al-Mu'mineen behind in Mecca is so that the Imam can return these trusts to the people. So Allah is telling the Prophet that, Ya Rasulullah, they trust you. They know that you are truthful. But this Islam that you are inviting them towards, it is at odds with their personal interests. You know, brothers and sisters, idol worship in Mecca wasn't only a religion, it was an economy. You know, the Kaaba that we see today, in Mecca, when the Holy Prophet began his mission, there were about 360 idols inside of the Kaaba. And all of the tribes, they would house their idols in this Kaaba. And when they would come from all around the Arabian Peninsula to perform the pilgrimage. So when people descend upon Mecca, you get money for tourism. The fact that you have all of these different idols that are attracting all of these different tribes to Mecca, you're talking about a very lucrative industry. Polytheism, idol worship, wasn't only a religion, it was the basis of their economy. So when Rasulullah comes forward and he says, these are all false gods, there's only one God, and he can hear you wherever you are, and you can speak to him wherever you are. He's closer to you than your jugular vein. What's going to happen to the Meccan economy? Those who are benefiting from this business of idol worship, it's going to crumble. So Allah is telling the Prophet that فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ, they do not think that you're not truthful or dishonest. وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ, these people are rejecting God. And this is also implied in the verse, that our reaction or our attitude towards the Prophet is indicative of our attitude towards God Himself. Can you imagine how great Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is, where the way that we treat Him, the way that we interact with Him, is a barometer for our relationship with Allah. If you look at Surah 48, verse 10, Allah equates how we treat the Prophet to how we treat him, the Lord. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايُعُونَكَ إِنَّمَا يُبَايُعُونَ اللَّهِ. O Muhammad, those who pay allegiance to you, who give bay'ah to you, they're giving allegiance to God Himself. If you look at Surah Ali Imran, verse 31, what does Allah say? قُلْ, say to them, O Muhammad, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ, if you love God, if you love Allah, the sign of your love for Allah is what? فَاتَّبِعُونِ, follow me. Rasulullah says, if you love Allah, follow me and Allah will love you. Meaning, imitate me, emulate me, follow in my footsteps. يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, if you follow me, you will be beloved to Allah and you will be worthy of Allah's forgiveness. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi is the closest being to Allah. Which means what? When we say someone is close to Allah, what does that actually mean? Closeness to Allah, divine proximity, essentially means that you become the strongest reflection of Allah's names. It's like the same thing with a mirror. The closer you are to the mirror, the more clear your reflection will be. The more powerful your reflection is, the closer you are to the mirror. Therefore, Rasulullah, because he is the closest one to Allah, he reflects Allah's names more powerfully than any being. So Allah's Rahmaniyyah is manifested in the Prophet more than any being because of his closeness to him. The Prophet's hikmah, his wisdom, is a reflection of Allah's wisdom. So he becomes the most powerful reflection of the divine attributes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again going back to the verse, قَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنْ إِنَّهُ لَيَحْزُنُكَ لَيَحْزُنُكَ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ. We know that you, Muhammad, are saddened by what they say. The word huzn in Arabic means grief, and it refers to anxiety or pain that was caused to you in the past. Whereas khawf, fear, refers to anxiety or uneasiness relating to something that may happen in the future. This is one of the differences between huzn and khawf. Fear is related to the future. Huzn is related to the past. If we go to the next ayah, by the way, you know, there was historians actually say that, you know, Abu Sufyan, Abu Jahl, these individuals who were at the forefront of the opposition against the Holy Prophet, they were the arch enemies of Rasulullah. Historians say that these individuals, Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, others, late at night, they would surround the house of the Prophet and they would listen to him recite the Quran. And when the other mushrikeen saw that there were other mushrikeen who were also there, they started to interrogate each other. What are you doing here? And they all admitted that they enjoyed listening to the Quran. There was a beauty to the Quran. So then they made it a pact that after tonight, we're not going to come and congregate outside of the house of Muhammad. That, you know, we have to make a firm stance that we're against him. We should not show any indication that we are inclined towards his message. The next day, they all came back, thinking that some of them may not show up. They all came back, and they would sit and they would listen to the Prophet recite the Quran. And then they finally came, they made a final agreement that we cannot be seen here, we cannot show that we are inclined to this message. And then they made a final decision that they're not going to show up at the Prophet's house at night. So you find that these individuals, they knew the Prophet was truthful. They knew that this is the truth, but their desires, and they had worldly interests that they were just not interested in sacrificing. If you go to the next verse, again, this is a continuation of this divine consolation that's being offered to the Prophet. وَلَقَدْ كُذِّبَتْ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ Ayah number 34. وَلَقَدْ كُذِّبَتْ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ فَصَبَرُوا عَلَى مَا كُذِّبُوا وَأُوذُوا حَتَّى أَتَاهُمْ نَصْرُنَا وَلَا مُبَدِّلَ لِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكَ مِن نَبَئِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. The translation reads, and certainly messengers before you were denied, but they were patient over the rejection and persecution until our help came to them. And none can alter the words of Allah, and certainly the tidings of some of the messengers have come to you. Now, again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to console the Prophet, reminds him. And subhanAllah, we all need reminders. It's not that the Holy Prophet doesn't know. You know, sometimes when people are sad or they feel demoralized, what you tell them is not something that they're ignorant of, but rather we human beings, we need reminders. فَذَكِّرْ إِن نَفَعَتِ الذِّكْرَى. Allah is reminding the Prophet. It's not that he doesn't know. Everyone needs a reminder. In fact, when Jibra'il used to descend upon the Prophet, Rasulullah would say to Jibra'il, Ya Jibra'il, عِذْنِي. Give me some advice. Which shows that all of us are in need of maw'idha. So Allah tells the Holy Prophet that the messengers before you were also rejected. They faced hostility and opposition, but they were patient. So this is an implicit way of Allah reminding the Prophet that you have to persevere. You have to be patient. فَصَبَرُوا عَلَى مَا كُذِّبُوا وَأُوذُوا. Not only were they called liars, prophets before you, Ya Rasulullah, they were physically assaulted. Many prophets were physically attacked. In fact, if you look at Nabi Nuh is an example of a prophet who was preaching for 950 years to his community. Talk about having patience. After 950 years, he was able to recruit 80 people. You know, if you do the math, that means one person would join him once every 12 years. Can you imagine if you open up a masjid, after 12 years, you're able to convert one person. You have one person praying behind you. This imam would probably be fired, right? For being so bad at da'wah, right? But again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not about the results, it's about the effort. Allah in Surah Nuh, Surah 71, verses 5 and 7, just to give you an idea of how the prophets suffered, how patient they were. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quotes Nuh. قَالَ رَبِّي. This is Nuh complaining. If anyone has a right to complain, it's Nuh. He says, قَالَ رَبِّي إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا. When does he complain? After 950 years of patience. This is when you have the right to complain. He says, oh my Lord, I have been inviting them day and night. Nuh, he would preach to them day and night. And when Nuh says day and night, he's not exaggerating. When you and I say I work day and night, we exaggerate because we have some days off. Nuh doesn't have any days off. Day and night, minimum of 2 lectures a day for 950 years. فَلَمْ يَزِدْهُمْ دُعَاءِ إِلَّا فِرَارًا. My preaching has done nothing than to make them even more disattached. They run away even more. They become even more hostile. They retreat. The more I speak, the more they retreat. And then he says, وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ. Whenever I invite them towards things that will earn divine forgiveness, what do they do? When Nuh speaks, talk about having a hostile audience. They put their fingers in their ears. وَاسْتَغْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ. They would cover their faces. They don't want to listen to Nuh, and they don't even want to look at him. وَأَصَرُّوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. They were so rebellious. This is what Nuh had to deal with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah 5, verse 70, He says, لَقَدْ أَخَذْنَا مِثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. We had a covenant with the children of Israel. وَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ رُسُلًا. Allah says, I sent many messengers to Bani Israel. Did they appreciate? No. Allah says, كُلَّمَا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ. Allah says, every time I would send them a messenger, not most of the time. كُلَّمَا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ بِمَا لَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُهُمْ فَرِيقًا كَذَّبُوا وَفَرِيقًا يَقْتُلُونَ. Allah says, every time I would send them a Rasul, a messenger, who was calling them to something that contradicted their desires, they either rejected him or they would kill that prophet or that messenger. Anbiya, they were physically attacked. You know, there's a, many of you, you know, you're familiar with Nabi Zakaria, Prophet Zakaria alayhi salam. He's the father of Yahya. He's mentioned in the Quran, a great prophet, great messenger of God. Do you know how Zakaria died? He didn't die a natural death. He was preaching to Bani Israel. Again, many of them, they were very hostile, very wicked. They decided that they were going to kill Zakaria because he was very vocal against the corruption during his time. So they decided that they're going to kill Zakaria. So they chase after him. Zakaria tries to hide and protect his life. He hides inside of the cavity of a tree. You know how there's some trees, they have an opening, you can go inside, these huge, massive trees. So he hid inside of a cavity, an opening. These individuals, they were looking for Zakaria and they noticed that he was hiding inside of one of the trees. Do you know what they did, brothers and sisters? They brought a big saw and they started to cut the tree with Zakaria inside. There's a tradition that says when the blade reached the flesh of Zakaria, he wanted to say, ah, you know, he wanted to express his pain. You and I, when we get a paper cut, we say, ah, the blade is cutting through Zakaria's flesh. He wants to say, ah, Jibreel descends and says, oh, Zakaria, if you say, ah, Allah will remove your name from the list of prophets. You have to be patient. This is the sabr that is required of Anbiya. You know, people, they ask, why didn't Allah choose us as prophets? It's because of this. How many of us have this type of sabr, this type of patience? So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is implicitly instructing the Prophet to show similar patience and confidence that Allah's help will come, as it did unfailingly in the past. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a sunnah. There is a divine law. What is this divine law? Allah mentions it in Surah Al-Mujadala, Surah 58, verse 21. What does Allah say? كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُلِي إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Allah has decreed, it is written, it is decreed, it is ordained. Allah says that me and my messengers will be victorious. Even if you kill them, even if you persecute them, their legacies will remain. And the victory will be with the believers. And this is true, brothers and sisters. How much did they curse Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam from the Manabir? How much did they try to smear his image? How much did they try to extinguish his remembrance? Those who tried to attack Amir al-Mu'mineen, their names have died with them. And Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, his name is elevated. How many people tried to silence the Holy Prophet? How many people tried to eradicate him and his message? Every day, in every country around the world, we hear Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. This is the victory, brothers and sisters. كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُلِي إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. So patience, brothers and sisters, when Allah tells the Prophet indirectly that you have to observe patience. Patience is not pacifism. It's not a call to passiveness. Rather, patience is a call for action. Patience doesn't mean that you suffer in silence. It means that you persevere. You're vigilant. You don't let personal attacks bring you down. You're not easily demoralized. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ali Imran, verse 200, he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu usbiru, O you who believe, be patient. Wasabiru, compete in being patient. Warabitu, be vigilant. Wattaqullah la'allakum tuflihun. Be patient. And patience, how do you develop patience? By trusting in Allah, by having ma'rifah in Allah. The more you know Allah, the more you trust Him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi says, As-sabru rida. Patience, the essence of patience is being satisfied with Allah's decree. That no matter what is happening to you, you know that it's in your best interest. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's a hadith from the Prophet where he says, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. How amazing is the affair of the believer. إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ. Everything that happens to him is good. If he's ill, it's for his own goodness. It's for his development. If he's healthy, it's good for him. If he's rich, it's good for him. If he's poor, it's good for him. Anything that Allah puts you through, when you're a believer, it's for your own spiritual growth. Nothing truly bad happens to the believer. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ, Rasulullah says. إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ. When Allah gives him, he's grateful. When Allah doesn't give them, he's still satisfied. He's thankful. He's patient. وَلَيْسَ ذَٰلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا الْمُؤْمِنِ. No person enjoys this except the believer. Anything that happens to the believer is for his own good. There's a hadith from Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam where he speaks about patience. Because this ayah is a call to patience. That the Prophet is, this is, you know, if you put this surah in its context, you know, you're talking about 10, 11, 12 years of persecution. It's not easy, brothers and sisters. You know, we complain about Islamophobia today. We have not seen Islamophobia. Islamophobia was in Mecca where Rasulullah goes down into sujood in front of the Kaaba and someone throws the intestines of a camel on his back. Where people are physically beaten for reciting the Quran. But here Allah is calling them to be patient. Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, patience is of three types. As-sabru imma sabrun ala al-musib. Patience is either patience in the face of calamity, tragedy and hardship, or ala al-ta'a. Sometimes you have to display patience when you fulfill your obligations, when you do good. Because the fruits of your labor are often not seen right away. It requires, in the same way that when you go to the gym and you work out, you have to be patient. You're not going to see results overnight. When you pray fajr, when you pray your salah on time, when you do salatul layl, you're not going to see the effects of it right away. It takes time. You have to be patient. أو عن المعصية, or patience in the face of sin. You may be tempted, but you have to restrain yourself. وهذا القسم الثالث, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, patience in the face of temptation is the highest level of patience. And this is true. It's easy to do your wajibat, but how difficult is it to avoid the muharramat? There are many Muslims who pray five times a day, but how many of them don't sin in a day? Observing patience in the face of sin. Also in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Nabi Ya'qub. Nabi Ya'qub is also a prophet who suffered a lot. He had a lot of bad kids, sons, who tried to kill his youngest child at the time. So he has to hear them lie about what happened to Yusuf. He separated from Yusuf. This is not easy. You know, brothers and sisters, when you go to a shopping mall and your child goes missing for a few minutes, especially mothers, you have a heart attack. Imagine decades go by and you don't see your child. What happens to you? Allah in the Quran tells us that Yaqub displayed sabrun jameel. Fasabrun jameel. Beautiful patience he displayed. When Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam was asked, what is the meaning of sabrun jameel, of beautiful patience? The Imam alayhi salam, he says, sabrun jameel, beautiful patience is, ذَلِكَ صَبْرٌ لَيْسَ فِيهِ شَكْوَى إِلَى النَّاسِ. Beautiful patience is when you have a problem, you don't express, you don't complain to anyone other than Allah. Because you recognize that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to take you out of the state of tribulation. And then the ayah ends, وَلَا مُبَدِّلَ لِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ. No one, none can alter the words of Allah. Here, kalimat of Allah refers to Allah's decrees, according to many mufassirin. That when Allah decrees something, there are certain divine sunnas, sunan, that govern existence. And these don't change. The fact that truth will always prevail over falsehood, this is a sunnah of Allah. That batil eventually crumbles is a sunnah. وَلَا مُبَدِّلَ لِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ. That the victory is for the muttaqeen. الْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And then Allah says, وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكَ مِنْ نَبَئِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And indeed, some of the tidings of the past messengers have already come to you. This is the Meccan period. Most likely Surah Yusuf has already been revealed. Allah has revealed many ayat relating to Musa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that we have already shared with you the stories of ancient prophets who endured similar trials and tribulations. I think, inshallah, we'll conclude here and we'll leave a few minutes for Q&A. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
If there are any questions or comments, inshallah, we'll take them now.
Assalamualaikum, Maulana.
Alaykum assalam.
I had a question. Is it true that Prophet Nuh's real name was not really Nuh, and it was something else?
Yes. So when you read the accounts that we have about Nabi Nuh, there are books written by our ulama on the stories of the prophets, and many of them are found in ahadith. The word Nuh was actually a title that was given to him. Nuh, some traditions say that, you know, his name was, you know, Abdul Jabbar, or he had other names, but Nuh was not one of his names. It was a title, and the word Nuh basically means the one who cries, or the one who weeps or laments. And they say that this title was given to him because of how much he used to weep when he would worship Allah. He would weep out of Allah's fear. Others say that because of how much he would weep for his community because of their corruption and their deviation. So Nuh was a title that was given to him.
Thank you.
Well, I have a question with regard to what you explained about being patient.
No.
What I would like to know is, I mean, some of us are more patient, some of us are less patient. Of course, that all doesn't compare to the patience of the prophets. So my question is, how do we practice of increasing our being more patient? What would you say about somebody that is not patient at all, and wants to improve being more patient, and but also somebody that is thinks, you know, that is patient and wants to improve?
Now, if you look at the ahadith, you know, as I mentioned, the ahadith seem to indicate that there is a relationship between ma'rifah of Allah and patience. The higher your ma'rifah of Allah is, the more patience you have. That's why prophets are the most patient. It's because they have the deepest knowledge of Allah. The more familiar you are with your Lord, the more patient you will be. Because at the end of the day, as I mentioned, Rasulullah, he says, "As-sabru ridha," that the essence of patience is to be satisfied with Allah's decree. The only way you can be satisfied with what Allah decrees is you have to become familiar with Him. You have to know Him. You have to increase your understanding of His names. You need to develop this this ma'rifah. And there are some ahadith that I'll share with you, maybe one hadith, from the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam, where they actually give advice on how to kind of develop patience. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, "Man yatasabbar yusabbirhu Allah." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, the Holy Prophet says, whoever tries to be patient, Allah makes him patient. You know the idea of, you know, fake it until you make it? We're familiar with this saying. If you make an effort to be patient, you try, you'll have this tawfiq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easier for you. And it's like the idea of you take one step and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take 10 steps towards you. So Amir al-Mu'mineen says, "Aslu husnu al-yaqeen, aslu sabr husnu al-yaqeen billah." You cannot have full patience unless you have yaqeen. So if there's a deficiency in your iman, in your faith, in your ma'rifah, your patience will suffer. You're not going to have this patience. And also being around, associating with people who are patient, because they'll have an influence on you. If you're around impatient people, chances are their impatience will rub off on you. But if you're around people who have a high degree of ma'rifah, who are patient, this will also have an influence on you. Any other questions?
Just as a follow-up on that, you also mentioned that being patient doesn't mean you need to be passive. It's a call for action. Can you explain that a little bit more, or give a number of examples if you have?
So patience in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says to the believers, "Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu isbiru wa sabiru wa rabitu," the word patience actually has a number of meanings in the Arabic language. Sabr means patience, but it also carries the meaning of perseverance, vigilance. When you do something, for example, when you start a project, like for example, this tafsir group that we've started, it requires patience to keep it going. You know, especially for example, when attendance drops, when, you know, life becomes busy, you can come up with a million reasons to cancel and say, "Listen, you know, we're not going to continue," or "I'm not going to participate anymore." But to persevere, no matter what you're going through in your life, this is sabr, this is patience. This is a practical example. To persevere, to always push yourself, and not make excuses. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and the Muslim community, they could have come up with a million reasons to say, "Listen, we're not going to invite people to Islam anymore. We're going to just make it a private cult, and that's it. Why should we go through this headache, this persecution?" No. You need to do what is right. Just because things become difficult, it doesn't mean you turn and you run away. A lot of sisters, they say, Shaykh, you know, it's becoming dangerous to wear the hijab. Can we just remove our hijab? No, you can't just remove your hijab. Patience is to wear the hijab, to go out, even if you get dirty looks, be patient. Continue to do good no matter how much hostility it generates, no matter how much adversity you face. Is it clear?
Yes, thank you. So another follow-up question that is how does making dua in case when you are in it to be to have sabr, how does making dua play a role here?
Play a role in sabr?
In cases where you need to have sabr.
As I mentioned with the hadith, you know, one of the meaning of one of the meanings of true patience is that you don't complain to anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, if you're going through a calamity, you ask Allah, oh Allah, you know, you have the attitude of prophets. Oh Allah, if this calamity is for my benefit, give me the strength to endure it. And if there are other ways that I can develop my spirituality, oh Allah, alleviate this and give me another trial. You know, if health is also going to enhance my spirituality, I prefer health over sickness. So you can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the strength to endure. You can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, and a lot of times, some of the trials that we experience in life, some of the things that Allah decrees for us, our dua has an effect on it. Allah's decree also takes into consideration how much we supplicate to Him. So our dua also plays a role in Allah's decree. That's why on the nights of Qadr we make dua. Based on our dua, based on our devotion on these nights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala determines our affairs, determines the sickness, the health, the wealth that we will face in the following. So our dua has a role in shaping our destiny.
Any other question?
One question. So just kind of a similar on that similar note, you mentioned that like when people are in going through troubles, like they might need a someone to like comfort them and stuff.
No.
So if someone's kind of, I guess kind of like, it seems a little bit contradictory, right? That say, hey, someone's like going through trouble and need someone to comfort them versus saying that like, if you're a believer, you should only be complaining or talking to Allah.
No.
Could you kind of elaborate on that a bit?
No. Sometimes, you know, again, believers are of different ranks. You know, not everyone is going to, you know, practice this 7 days a week, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. There may be cases where, you know, a believer, it's noticeable that something is bothering them. But even, so sometimes you have believers who, the sadness is visible. Or you have other believers where they don't look like anything is bothering them, but because you're always in touch with them, you know that they have certain problems, right? So if you're in touch with people, if you interact with them, you might not see any signs of sadness or depression in them, but you know that they're going through circumstances that would cause any normal person to feel sad and distressed. You see? So for example, if I have a friend who's a mu'min, and they're always very cheerful, but I know because I'm close with him and I interact with them that he recently lost his job. I know that he might not say it, but this is probably causing him distress. So before he even asks me, I console him and I try to help him. You see? So sometimes knowing their circumstances could allow you to make that inference that they're probably going through a tough time. Even if they're smiling and they're very cheerful, the mu'min doesn't express this grief. You know, they're very cheerful, they're very pleasant. But you as a mu'min who keeps in touch with fellow believers, you should be aware of the circumstances and the living conditions of other mu'mineen. You know, this is one of the benefits of Salatul Jumu'ah, going to the mosque. So you build this sense of community. You know what people are going through.
Also, Sheikh, how do we reach out to people who are going through a hard time without kind of like letting that, you know, without affecting us, like without letting that bring us down, you know? Like just because you feed off each other's energy all the time, so.
Yeah. I mean, I think, I agree. I mean, I think if you're around people who are, you know, very negative and depressed, it does have an effect on you. But I think if, you know, you spend an hour with a person every couple weeks, I don't think it's going to really be that detrimental. And, you know, if you feel that someone is sad, you know, you don't obviously go up to them and be like, you know, I feel that you're sad and I'm here to console you. You know, sometimes you just call them up, be like, you know, let's go out for some coffee. Make it very casual. Don't make them feel like you're consoling them. Just be very casual and have it be very natural. So, I mean, spending a few minutes, you know, a couple of hours every month or every couple of weeks with a fellow believers, that shouldn't have, you know, any, you know, adverse effects on your psyche.
Okay, thank you.
If you do, if it does, then maybe there's Zoloft. You can go to the pharmacy or something.
Horses, Zoloft.
Sheikh, maybe the last question, if there's no other questions.
Yes.
If you remember, we had a homework from last week, the last question that we had about
what's the purpose of meeting Allah?
Yeah. To be honest, I didn't do my homework. Now we are back to the teacher to explain it.
No, if you don't do your homework, the teacher punishes the class. So, again, from my limited understanding, this could be right, it could be not, but liqa'ullah, you're asking what is the purpose of the meeting? The meeting doesn't have a goal outside of the meeting, meaning the meeting is the goal itself. Meaning what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created man to worship him, yes? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. But ibadah is not the goal. The ibadah is the vehicle that will allow you to reach the goal. What is the goal? Attaining or moving towards perfection. If it really boils down to happiness. If I ask you, why do you go to school? I go to school so I can get a degree. Why do you get a degree? So I can get a job. Why do you want a job? Because I need to make money. Why do you want to make money? Because I want to buy a house, I want to buy a car, I want to get married. Why do you want to do these things? Because I want to be happy. Do you ask someone, why do you want to be happy? No. Just like Aristotle says, happiness is the end goal. Meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the highest pleasure. If you meet Allah Azza wa Jal with a pure heart and you are able to expose yourself to His mercy, you remove the veils between you and Him, that is the ultimate joy in existence. That's why in Jannah, what differentiates those who are in the higher levels of Jannah and in the lower levels is those who are in the higher levels, they're closer to Allah. Allah is pleased with them. There are less veils between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the objective of the meeting is the meeting itself. Removing the veils to experience the joy of divine proximity. It's like saying that, what's the purpose of meeting my wife? Or meeting someone that you love. The purpose is experiencing the joy of being in that person's presence. Do you see? Again, this is just my understanding. I don't know if anyone else has another answer.
Thank you, Sheikh.
Assalamu alaikum. Okay, brothers and sisters, it is about 12:22 my time. I'm about to crash. So I hope you guys have an enjoyable iftar. Please keep me in your dua, and inshallah, we will continue our session next week, and then maybe the week after that. The week after that, and then after that, I'll be inshallah in Seattle with you.
Inshallah.
Thank you.
Please keep me in your dua. Assalamu alaikum.